Welcome friends to yet another Indian knowledge series video. In this video number 27, we will be discussing Indian 103 business combinations. You may be aware that we have a reasonably equivalent standard in IGAAP, which is AS-14 amalgamations. But if you consider Indian 103, I remember the discussion we had in the earlier periods of drafting Indian standards. If at all, if somebody has to ask, what is the significant difference between Indian GAAP and Indian, we used to tell that if we eliminate fair value measurement, if we eliminate Indian 103, if we eliminate the extensive disclosure which we are having, and if we are eliminating the standards on financial instrument, Ind AS is equivalent to IGAAP. So now you will understand that this one particular standard is really a complex standard and has a lot of intricacies which we are supposed to consider to understand. So we will discuss at length with a lot of examples and case studies to understand the concept of this particular standard. At the same time, I request you to post all your questions, comments, and inputs in our YouTube channel so that I will answer them for the benefit of all our subscribers in one single go. With that, let me move on to the structure of our discussion. We will, as usual, try to understand what are scoped in Ind AS 103 business combination and what are all the items which are not covered under Ind AS 103. These two items we will first discuss. Secondly, we will understand what is the core principles of business combination accounting as per Ind AS 103. Thirdly, we will see what is the accounting principles which is coming by this particular standard. Why we believe that this standard is comparatively rigor with Indian GAAP. Maybe the standard setters have understood that there is complexity in application of this particular standard, and accordingly they have given a lot of guidances. What I am trying to do is that I am splitting that guidances into 5-step process to understand the acquisition method of accounting which has been explained in this particular standard. So the step-by-step process will enable us to understand it better manner. We know what is goodwill, and the accounting treatment of goodwill under Ind AS 103 is totally different compared to what we are doing in AS 14. We will discuss that. And how to determine goodwill also we will see. Similarly, we normally used to talk about capital reserve in amalgamations, right? Instead of capital reserve, we are trying to use the word gain on bargain purchase as per Ind AS 103. And there is a carve out between 103 and IFRS 3. We will discuss that aspect as well. Maybe an entity, when it acquires the other entity, it acquires 100% of the equity or shareholding of the other company, or it may be acquiring only a controlling stake. To that extent, there could be other non-controlling interest shareholders. How to measure that non-controlling interest and recognize as part of Ind AS 103, we will look into that particular aspect as well. What is mean by provisional accounting? Normally, when we do accounting, we have the numbers upfront, and based on that, we will pass the entry. But this standard says that sometimes if the amounts are not fully agreed, there is some provisional numbers which has been agreed. You can go ahead and account the business combination by using provisional accounting concepts given in Ind AS 103. We will discuss that aspect as well. We will also see what you mean by step acquisition. Suppose if an entity already has 30% and it takes another pickup in the same company, which gives it a controlling stake. We call it is as a step-by-step acquisition, the point at which the control is being acquired. Then that should be accounted as per Ind AS 103. The previously held interest before taking the control should be accounted in a different style. That is what is the guidance given in Ind AS 103. There is certain transaction which are considered as common control transaction. For example, a group of company is owned by a set of shareholders or a company. Maybe the ultimate parent company is A Limited. In between, there are three companies. Out of the three company, one company has been acquired by another company. But ultimately, what happens is the shareholders remaining to be the same because ultimate parent company is same, right? In that particular situation, whether the accounting should be based on the five-step process or there is a separate accounting treatment which is there. That is also we will consider as part of our discussion today. And after having done the accounting, what are all the important disclosures which has to be made for the purposes of making the user to understand this particular accounting treatment? That comes as part of our disclosures. And finally, we will talk about Ind AS versus AS 14. What are all the significant differences? We will look into that particular aspect as well. Okay, when we are talking about scope in, what are all the things which are covered? A business combination is considered to be a transaction or other event in which one party called acquirer obtains control of one or more businesses of the acquiree. So that is what is called a business combination that is covered as per Ind AS 103. To understand this key concept, let us split the important terms. It talks about a transaction. That means there should be a contractual arrangement between one party and another party. One party is acquirer and another party is acquiree. And that should be the for the purposes of taking control or acquiring control of a business. So transaction in which one party acquires the control of the business, one or more business of the acquiree. Okay, that is one part. What do you mean by other event? I have not done anything. I have not entered into a transaction. I have not entered into a contract to acquire the control of the other entity. But I remained with the same shareholding which I hold. But I become the party who has the control over the business. Let me take this simple example. Maybe it may come as a case study subsequently, but still to make the concept easier, I will take this straight away. Assuming that I'm holding around 40% of the voting rights of another entity. What is my stake in that company? Mine is only a significant influence and not a control. So whatever I have picked up is a transaction by which I am not able to get any control over the other business. And accordingly, it is not a business combination with 40%. After 1 year, the company offers a buyback of shares. 50% of the holding of every shareholder is being offered for buyback and cancellation. I have not opted for the buyback. All other shareholders have opted for the buyback. What happens? 50% of the shares should have been bought back. But since I have not offered for buyback, 30% of the shares have been already purchased and cancelled. So now what I am holding now, without any change, any transaction, I am holding 40% of 70%, and 40% of 70%, if we have to see, it results somewhere around 57% of the total shareholding of the company. Previously, I was holding only 40%, which was only giving me a significant influence. But now, when other shareholders have agreed for a buyback, I have kept my own shareholding. I have not opted for the buyback. To that extent, 30% of the total shareholding come down, and out of 70% which is remaining, I am holding 40%, which results almost 57%. A event which has happened where there is no contractual right, there is no transaction, there is no consideration, but still that event made me to have the control over the shareholding of the other business or businesses is also considered as a business combination. So last year with 40%, I might have considered that as an associate, but with 57%, if I have proved to have control in the composition of the board of directors, naturally what will happen? When I am appointing somebody or nominating somebody for election in the board, automatically those people will be get elected as the directors of the company, and I have control over the composition of the board of directors of the company, right? So to that extent, in the current year, I have control over the business of the other entity, even though I have not entered into any transaction. Some event have happened which gave me the power to control the business or businesses of the acquiring company. So a transaction which is a contractual relationship will result in a control over the business or businesses of another entity is a business combination. Or another event which is having which happened resulted in an entity having control over the business of another entity is also a business combination. Both are covered under Ind AS 103. Let us move on to the next aspect which we are supposed to look into. What is excluded? Suppose if it is a joint arrangement, when I'm saying joint arrangement, I don't have a control, but I have only a joint control. Each party is having a control and I am also having a joint control. So if there is a joint arrangement in which I have picked up some shares, that is not considered as a business combination. Similarly, when I have acquired investment in another entity, but I am an investment entity, I am not a manufacturing entity or a trading entity or a commercial entity, but my nature of operation itself is to only make investment in another company, even though I have picked up more than 50% of the total voting rights, if I am going to fair value that investment as fair value through P&L, that means it is actually moving towards Ind AS 109 and not Ind AS 103. In that situation also, I will not apply Ind AS 103. Similarly, this contractual arrangement allows me to purchase only a particular asset or a group of assets and not the entire business. In that case also, this is not considered as Ind AS 103. It's not a business combination. So business combination means there should be a transaction or other event which results in a control being acquired by the acquirer on one or other businesses. Exception is joint venture arrangement, where investment entities is invested, and when the acquisition is not a business but only acquisition of an asset or group of asset, right? So in that particular situation, let us try to understand by means of what is the core principle which we have to apply, whether to use Ind AS 103 or not to use Ind AS 103. Let us make this in a simple pattern. The core principle says, is a transaction is an acquisition of assets or acquisition of a business. So acquisition of assets, we know pretty well, it's a purchase of some asset, maybe tangible assets or intangible assets, or other assets as well, maybe a financial asset as well. Is it a transaction for acquisition of asset or acquisition of business? What is the thing which we are doing? Suppose if I'm saying, no, it is not acquisition of a business, but it's only an acquisition of an asset. When I'm saying, is it acquisition of asset or group of asset? If I'm saying, yes, it's a transaction where a group of assets are acquired from another entity, then whatever consideration I have paid should be allocated based on the fair value of individual assets. The entire cost of consideration should be allocated based on the fair value of the individual assets to all the assets in the group, if I'm purchasing a group of assets. Suppose if I'm saying, no, it's not group of assets, I'm purchasing only one single asset. you have to see what is the specific standard by which you have to account for it. For example, if I'm saying it is a property, plant and equipment which I have acquired, then I go for Ind AS 16, which says the cost of acquisition should be the cost of cost to be accounted on the initial measurement. Suppose if I am talking about an intangible asset or investment property, in both the cases also cost of acquisition should be the cost to be recognized initially. Suppose if I am saying it's a financial instrument which I am purchasing, to that extent it should be accounted at fair value on initial measurement. Day one profit or loss should be dealt with in accordance with the respective standard. That's what Ind AS 109 is talking about. We will see Ind AS 109 separately. So the first question which we are asking is whether we are acquiring asset or group of assets or business. If it is a group of asset, the consideration will be allocated to the various assets in the group based on their individual fair value. If it is an individual asset which is purchased by in the transaction, then we will use the specific standard based on which we will account it. Suppose if we are saying no, it is a purchase of business, then we will enter into Ind AS 103. So only if a business is acquired, then we will talk about Ind AS 103. Whether purchase of a business itself will allow you to go to Ind AS 103, the other core principle says whether control is obtained by means of that particular purchase transaction over the investing entity. A Limited purchases the shares of B Limited, say 70%, but the transaction says B Limited, being the owner of some technical knowledge, will continue to have the right to appoint majority of the board of directors of the company, and A Limited agrees to be a passive investor in that particular situation. Even though A Limited has 70% of the voting rights, it does not have control over the investing company. So even if there is a transaction of acquiring a business, the next important point which we have to see is that whether it results in acquisition of control being obtained over the investing company. If I am saying yes, then we will use acquisition method and account for the business combination as per Ind AS 103. Suppose if I am saying no, control is not obtained, but I have entered into a transaction to acquire the voting rights in the other company, I have to look for the specific standard. In that particular situation where 70% has been acquired, but still I don't have any control, I have only a significant influence, I will treat that as an investment in an associate and apply my Ind AS 28 for the purposes of accounting, right? So only if control is obtained in a transaction where one entity acquires the business of another entity, we will apply Ind AS 103. There are two core principles which we have to see. Business should be acquired. That acquisition should result in control being obtained. Then only Ind AS 103 will be applied. Now, we were repeatedly using the word business, business, business. What is business? To put it in simple terms, it is an integrated set of activities and the related assets. That means input, process and output. On all the activities, I should have the control. That is called the business. If I am purchasing the entire thing, input, process and output related activity. What do you mean by input? Input activity could be I purchase the machinery of an entity. What is the process? I require the production process. I require the HR process. I require the selling process. So all this process is also purchased along with that. And because of that, there is an output which is maybe economic benefits which is coming to that particular entity by means of sale, profits, dividend or interest, whatever you call, is arising out of that. All these input, process and output combined together is called an integrated set of activity. That is called a business. If I am only purchasing an asset but not the integrated set of activities, it is not a business combination. And accordingly, it is outside the purview of Ind AS 103. So what should be that integrated set of activities and assets, how it should be capable of being conducted and managed for the purpose of providing return in the form of dividend, lower cost optimization, or other economic beneficiary directly to the investor or their owners, members, or participants. In simple terms, you are controlling the input, process, and outputs. The output results in the form of dividend, lower cost, or economic benefits to the owners or the investors or the members or participants. That we call it as a business, right? The rebuttable presumption, the standard says, is that in case an entity is purchasing, entering into a transaction in which they have measured something as goodwill. If goodwill is also there in the group of asset, it is assumed that you are purchasing a business, because goodwill is not a separately identifiable asset. It is normally belonging to the business. So accordingly, it is considered a business. And moreover, goodwill is always considered as a residual value. After all the assets and liabilities have been identified, what is left over is considered as a goodwill after you are comparing that with the cost of acquisition or the consideration which you are paying. So to that extent, goodwill, if it is present in a group of asset which is being purchased by means of a transaction in which control is also happening, then that is necessarily a business. That is an important aspect, that it's a business. It's a rebuttable presumption, but of course you can challenge it, but very rare circumstances you will be able to challenge that particular situation. Okay. What do you mean by business? It says it's input, that is any economic resource that it creates, for example, property, plant, equipment, intangible assets, ability to access the necessary materials, rights, or employees, or input resources, where I have the control over input resources. And I also have the control over the processes to operate. For example, management processes, operational processes, resource management processes, manufacturing processes, selling and administrative activities, the entire processes along with the inputs which is being purchased, which results in an output. I am entitled for the result of the output by means of dividend or interest or any other cost optimization by using that particular thing. That becomes my business. So input, process, and output all should be together. Then only we will consider that transaction as a transaction for acquisition of a business. Otherwise, it will be considered as an acquisition of only a set of assets or a particular asset. Okay. With that, let us try to understand this concept with a simple example. For example, if I'm saying that I am purchasing, two options which we are talking about is, first option which we are talking about is that ABC Limited purchases a hotel building. Purchase of a hotel building in itself is purchase of a business? Yes, you are correct. No, it is not a purchase of business. It is only purchase of a particular asset. So you are only purchasing the input. You are not purchasing the process. You are not entitled for the output because the process is not being purchased. Not the entire outputs is being done. Only for the particular asset there is an output. You are entitled for it. But the process is not actually purchased. You are going to use your processes for economically exploit that particular asset which you are purchasing. So simple purchase of a hotel building is only a purchase of an asset. Maybe if you are going to use it for rental to others, it may be an investment property. If you are going to use that as your corporate office, then it will be your property, plant, equipment. But it will never be an acquisition of a business. On the second option, I am just twisting this option with a small change, where we are trying to say that here the entity purchases the hotel building along with the employees, along with the reservation system, operating system, procedures, and other policies. And more importantly, it also has regular customers and long-term operations in the particular sector and has a brand name. So because of that, when you purchase with all the processes along with the related assets, you are entitled for the output which is generated by that particular asset and the processes, right? In that case, A is only purchase of a particular asset, you have to go to the respective standard, whereas in B, it is purchase of a business, you have to consider Ind AS 103, provided it also obtains control over the other entity. Then you will consider that. Let's take some more example. Here I am saying entity B is a development stage pharma company. Development stage means it develops a technical know-how with a license to develop a particular drug. Company A acquires all the outstanding shares of entity B. Entity B has no employees and no other assets. Clinical trials and/or the development are not being performed, and company has no intention to pursue the plans to produce outputs in future. Company A plans to raise funds in the entity and commence initial clinical trials for the drug. Whether company B represents a business. Even though company B as a whole could be a business, see the way in which A is acquiring. A is only acquiring the inputs and it does not have any plans for the outputs. It may continue the development stage and develop a particular drug. So that means it's nothing but it is worried about the input and not the processes. Maybe the output comes as part of a technical know-how or a cost reduction, but still the processes, integrated processes are not being purchased. To that extent, B does not represent a business, but it has to be accounted as an acquisition of an asset under, maybe because it's a drug related license, the formulations under development will be intangible assets covered by Ind AS 38, and the related machinery and plant which you are purchasing will be Ind AS 16 property, plant and equipment. Because in this example, they have said that they don't have an intention of going for production of the outputs. So outputs is not there, only two inputs and processes are there. So to that extent, they are not considered as a purchase of a business. Let us understand another example. A Limited purchases 5 investment properties that are fully rented to tenants. A Limited also takes over the contract for the property management company, which makes all decisions relating to the daily operations of the property. Ancillary activities relating to maintenance of the building and administrating of the tenants are also in process, in place, whether the acquired set constitute a business or not. What's your view? Yes, inputs is there, processes is there, output is also there, and accordingly, the investment property is purchased by means of purchasing the entire business of an entity, and accordingly that will be considered as an acquisition of the business of the other entity. Because the 5 investment properties in a transaction of acquiring the shareholding of another company means that the property management company is being acquired in the transaction, right? It's an acquisition of the business of the property management company. Let us take one more example. It is a chemical manufacturing group which operates a caustic soda manufacturing business throughout the world. The group structure is organized to be tax efficient, and accordingly this particular business is made up of a group of companies in some countries, a separate subsidiary in some countries, and a division of the larger company in some other countries. What it says is that the parent company sets up smaller units in various other countries for the purposes of tax efficient structure, and it has its own business that is being set up there. Whether that is considered, when it is actually setting up a subsidiary, is it an acquisition of a subsidiary there? Is it a business combination? The caustic soda business own management system, managed as a separate profit center. It has access to all the inputs and access processes necessary to manufacture the resins and caustic soda and generate revenues. Whether the caustic soda business is a business as per Ind AS 103. If you see this transaction, I'm only adding another entity in the group structure. I'm not acquiring any business. It is an existing business. For the purposes tax efficient, I am setting a legal structure. When a simple legal structure has been added to the existing structure, it does not constitute an acquisition of a business, and to that extent, Ind AS 103 will not apply. You have to be careful. Here, I am not acquiring any business. I am only creating a structure of my subsidiaries for the purposes of carrying on my business throughout the world in a tax efficient manner. This type of legal structure is normally considered as a common control transaction. Before and after, the same shareholders are controlling the business, right? Controlling the group. So to that extent, it is considered as a common control transaction. In that particular scenario, it is not normally a business combination accounting. Let us take some more example. Because it's a complex standard, we need to discuss a lot of examples. It is a consumer products group company which owns rights and patents to a large number of brands. The brands are exploited in different ways by subsidiaries throughout the world. The group is managed by reference to a geographically determined profit center, maybe Asia Pacific, Middle East, like that they have set up that, but it owns a large number of brands. The brands do not have all the inputs and processes needed to generate revenues. For example, the individual brand does not have access to manufacturing or distribution facility. If at all the company wanted to sell the brands, is it considered as a business? And if somebody is acquiring that particular brands, is it a case of acquiring of the business of A itself or a portion of A's business itself? Because we are talking about all inputs and processes are not there. Only brand is there. It is only acquisition of a specific asset or group of asset, because we are saying large number of brands. So to that extent, whatever consideration paid is to be allocated towards the fair value of each of the brands. So it is only acquisition of group of assets and not acquisition of business. To that extent, 103 will not apply. Interestingly, we are going to take one more example. A new parent company is added in the existing group by setting up a new shell company that issues equity shares to the existing shareholder. So this is also like what we have seen before. Here what we are saying, A Limited is the parent company, assuming that it has B, C, D, and it has A Limited formed one more company which is 100% subsidiary, say assuming D Limited. That D Limited acquires all the shares of B, C, D, right? So in this case, D Limited is already there. Assuming that we are going for F Limited, A, B, C, D, E Limited or F Limited, we'll take F Limited. F Limited has been made as the immediate step down parent after A, and it will be holding the shares of B, C and D. In that case, it is again putting a legal structure and not a business combination. It is normally considered as not acquisition of a business. It is a common control transaction. Those common control transactions are also covered as Ind AS 103. Interestingly, IFRS 3 on business combination is not specifically talking about common control transaction, but we have added Appendix C as part of Ind AS 103 to define the accounting treatment for common control transaction. Okay. Now, let's take another example. Entity A has acquired Entity B's broadcasting and production operations. The shares of B are purchased by 100% subsidiary of Entity A, located in a low tax jurisdiction. So directly it is not purchasing, it is purchasing through one of its subsidiary. The production facilities and related staff will be acquired by Entity A's operating subsidiaries in each country. Because it's operating in various countries, the shares will be acquired by one subsidiary, but the other subsidiaries of A will be taking over the production facilities and related staff. Entity B will be fully liquidated none of the transaction can complete unless all the transactions complete. Whether this is a business combination, yes, it is a linked transaction. What is a linked transaction? I will purchase your company and you can be liquidated. But what I will do is, whatever I purchase will be through my subsidiary, and the users of the facilities and input, output and processes will be other subsidiaries in other countries. So it is a linked transaction, and accordingly, entity A shall account the acquisition of entity B as per Ind AS 103, business combination. Okay, we have seen purchase of an asset or group of asset, which we said is not a business combination. Purchase of a business along with the input, process and output, we said it's a business. We have also seen cases where in between a legal structure is brought in, but the control remaining to be same with the same old shareholders before and after the change has happened. In that case, it is covered not as a business combination, but as per Ind AS 103, as part of your common control transactions. Forms of business combination, it's a list of examples which you may be aware that I acquire one or more business by acquiring the equity of another entity, by which the other entity will become subsidiary of the acquirer. So I am purchasing the controlling stake. Maybe it is not a company, but it's an unincorporated business, and that is being acquired by the acquirer and are legally merged into the acquirer. So I have purchased the business of an unincorporated body, not as a subsidiary, but it's merged with the acquirer's business. That is also another possibility. One is acquisition, another is merger. All combining entities transfer their equity interest or net assets to a newly formed entity, spin-off, demerger, whatever you are talking about, that could also be possible. A group of former owners of one of the combining entities gets a control of the combined entity. So some of the owner is actually taking over the possession of all the combined entities, could be a possibility, or maybe it may be a transaction or event which is happening by which automatically a person becomes a control, having a controlling stake, like what we have seen in buyback. These are all examples of business combination. Let's try to understand. Entity A Limited owns 40% investment in an investee company that gives significant influence but not control. During the year, investee offered a buyback which was opted by Entity A. This resulted in the increase of the proportionate interest of A Limited. That's what I have said. 40% I have hold, 50% has been acquired by means of a buyback option, but I have not opted for it. My holding in a transaction, no, there is no transaction. In an event, it has become my controlled entity. So by means of an event, if there is something happening also, I should apply Ind AS 103. That's what we have seen earlier, right? How we have to account for business combination? How we have to account for business combination is an important aspect which we are supposed to consider. One is an acquisition method. We will apply acquisition method for all business combination. We will apply this for all business combination. Only exception is where the business combination results in a common control transaction. That means before and after the acquisition of one particular business, or merger of two entities, or demerger of another entity, creating a new transfer structure into that. In all scenarios, the original owners of the business or original shareholders who control the business remaining to have the control even after that particular transaction has happened. That is the only exception from acquisition method. In all other cases, the business combination should be accounted based on acquisition method. What do you mean by acquisition method? Acquisition method, to put it in simple terms, is equivalent to the purchase method given as per AS 14. Only thing is, in AS 14, you are permitted to use carrying amount or cost of the asset also as a accounting for business combination or amalgamation, but that option is not available when it comes to Ind AS 103. If I am acquiring another business which is not common control transaction, then my purchase accounting or acquisition method of accounting should be based on the fair value of the net assets I have taken over. What is the fair value of individual assets? And what is the fair value of individual liability? What is the net figure which I have taken over minus the consideration, may be giving result to some goodwill or capital reserve, or capital reserve is called as gain on bargain purchase. That should be accounted for as per acquisition method. All business combinations should be accounted as per acquisition method. Only one exception is common control transaction. Okay. Pooling of interest method, we know as per AS 14, that will be applied only to common control transaction. So common control transaction will be accounted as per pooling of interest method. It will not be accounted as acquisition method. All other items will be, all other business combination will be accounted as per acquisition method. Suppose if the acquisition has been done based on some quote schemes, there are some special consideration which we have to take into consideration. We'll so see those discussions as well. As I have said, to understand the complex concept of acquisition accounting, I am splitting that into five step process. What is the five steps? First, you have to determine who is the acquirer, for which we should understand what is the meaning of acquirer. We will see that. The first step is you have to identify the acquirer, because acquirer is going to account for the business combination as per the acquisition method, in accordance with Ind AS 103. So accounting treatment is in the books of the acquirer. Accordingly, we should understand who is the acquirer. Second is, what is the date on which I have to pass these entries in the financial statement for the business combination? For that purpose, I should understand what is the acquisition date as defined in Ind AS 103. Only on that particular date, I should recognize all the fair value of assets taken over and all the liabilities which at fair value, which has been agreed to be taken over, and related goodwill or a capital reserve as the case may be. So determining the acquisition date is an important thing. On the acquisition date, I will recognize and measure what are all the identifiable assets which I have acquired as part of the business combination? What are all the liabilities which I am taking over from the existing business, or liabilities which are assumed? And sometimes I am not 100% owner. What is the related non-controlling interest? So I took 70%, but in consolidation I am taking line by line. That means I am taking 100% of the assets, 100% of the liabilities, 100% of the income, 100% of the expenses. But at the same time, what is the profit attributable to the non-controlling interest should be shown separately. What is the capital and the portion of the other equity which is related to the non-controlling interest should be shown separately. Accordingly, we should identify what is the assets taken over, what is the liabilities assumed, and what is the non-controlling interest in step 3. And step 4, we have to recognize and measure whether any goodwill or gain or a bargain purchase arises. Goodwill arises when the consideration is in excess of the net value of assets taken over. Gain on bargain purchase is consideration paid is lower than the net value of assets taken over. Okay, so that is the step 4, how to recognize. And finally, based on the assets identified, liabilities assumed, non-controlling interest which I have to determine, what is the goodwill or gain on bargain purchase, that should be compared with the consideration, and the entry should be passed for recognizing the consideration paid as well as recognizing the asset on the date of acquisition in the books of the acquirer. That is the reason why we are saying first identified who is the acquirer. In his books of accounts on the date of acquisition, we have to recognize and measure the identifiable asset, liabilities, non-controlling interest, recognize the related goodwill or gain on bargain purchase, and account for all the transactions, accounting for the assets taken over, accounting for the liabilities assumed, accounting for the non-controlling interest, accounting for the goodwill, accounting for the capital reserve, if any. All those things will be recognized as step 5. This is 5 steps. If we understand, we need not worry about Ind AS 103 as far as the acquisition method is concerned. You have to only put that principle with the numbers which is given in your questions. Step 1, identifying the acquirer. Who is the acquirer? The person who is obtaining the control over the other entity or business. That's what I was regularly saying. No, A Limited takes 70% stake in B Limited. So A Limited is the acquirer because it obtains control over the financial and operating policies over the other entity or other business. So that is the acquirer. Control. Taking over of the control is important and not just a shareholding pattern. That's what I have said in another example. I hold 70%, another person is having 30%, still the other person is permitted to nominate directors and I don't have the power to nominate anybody because the other person with whom I have agreed that I will not nominate. So to that extent, I am only a passive investor, no control. I am becoming a shareholder with non-controlling interest. In that case, there is no acquisition of control. And accordingly, I am not the acquirer. I am only an investor in that particular entity. Maybe it will result in a significant influence which can be accounted as per Ind AS 28 equity method of accounting. Or otherwise, even significant influence cannot be demonstrated. I should recognize only as a financial asset in my books of accounts. Right? That's what step 1. So step 1 says you should have a control. What is control? Control says it's a right which an investor is getting, and with that right, he has the ability to direct the activities of the investing company, which will significantly affect the returns. In simple terms, on financial and operating policies, I have the control. Because of that, what is the dividend coming in, profit coming in, or any other returns which is coming to the investor from the investees will be considered as part of the control. If I have the power to do the ability to direct the activities of the other entity, and other entity's returns is in accordance with what I will significantly affect by means of my decisions, will be considered as part of control. So if I split that, there is an existing right that gives current ability. Existing right comes based on purchase of the shares and it can be immediately exercisable. Okay, that power of shareholding, whether results in I have the ability to appoint somebody else in the composition of the board of directors, if I could control the financial and operating policies in order to direct the activities significantly to affect the investor's return, if both are existing, then there is a control by the acquirer. This assessment should always be tested at every reporting period. That's what I'm saying. Control is being assessed on continuous basis. It is not one-time assessment and I conclude that the other entity is my subsidiary and I have accounted on business combination. It may be moving towards a situation where I lose control, or previously I don't have control but I have taken a control now. The moment I take the control, I'm falling into Ind AS 103 accounting principles, right? That is what we have to consider. How control may be demonstrated? You may be aware that maybe voting rights more than half of the other entity's voting power, power to govern and financial and operating policies, maybe because of my voting rights, or maybe because of statute, or because of I entered into an agreement with the other party. So where they will be voting in favor of whatever decision, or they have given a power of attorney to run the entire business, and they become a passive investor, could be another possibility. Power to appoint and remove majority of the company's board of directors in case of a company, or any other governing body in case of other entity. But since we are going to talk about only composition under the Companies Act, we are looking for normally a board of directors. And sometimes if you are acquiring the business of an unincorporated body, then you have to see, or you are getting the control over the governing body. Power to cast majority of the votes, or maybe in the governing body. So that will also give. So the moment whatever resolution which I am planning to pass, that resolution will automatically pass because I have the majority of the voting rights. That's the reason why in IGAP, we start with the voting rights. Here it says voting rights is not the only driver. You have to see all the other patterns, because you may be having a controlling interest with less than 50%. The other group may be having non-controlling interest with 70%. Okay. All possibilities could be possible. That's what we are saying. Shareholding alone is no more the driver to decide the control. You have to see the other aspects as well. Let's take an example. P Limited acquires 40,000 equity shares of X Limited out of total share capital of 1 lakh shares. That means P Limited has acquired only 40% shares of X Limited, not more than 50%, right? So the rebuttable presumption is not coming in. P Limited also purchases an option to acquire additional 25 shares. The option is exercisable at any point of time within the next 12 months. The exercise price holds a small premium to the market on the transaction date. After the above transaction, the shareholding of P Limited's two other original shareholders are 35,000 and 25,000. That means originally 40,000 and 35,000 and 25,000. They will have, that means P Limited has an option outstanding which can be exercised at any point of time. That means 40,000 shares will become 65,000 shares at any point of time, compared to 35,000 and 25,000 held by other two group of shareholders. Now, they also have exercisable option, but it's only 2,000. So 35,000 will become 37,000, 25,000 will become 27,000, whereas entity P's shareholding will become 40,000 plus 25, 65,000. So 65,000 plus 37,000 plus 27,000, 27,000 is the total number of shares of the revised entity, 1,29,000. On 1,29,000, I am going to hold 65,000 divided by 1,25,000 gives me a percentage of 52%, whereas the other people's shareholding, for example, 37,000 divided by 1,25,000 comes to only 29%. It is actually fallen from 35% to less than 30%, 35%. Similarly, other case also it will go down. So to that extent, P Limited with the exercisable option will have the controlling stake in the X Limited, and to that extent it is actually controlling X Limited. So accordingly, in case when it takes 40,000 plus another 25,000 shares which can be exercised at any point of time, it is actually acquiring the business of X Limited in a business combination, right? Are clear? What is the indications of an acquirer? We are saying control should be there. What is the indication of an acquirer? Voting rights will be much higher compared to others on the combined entity. Large minority voting interest will be there in the combined entity. That means I am having controlling stake, others having non-controlling stake. Composition of the governing body or the board of directors are being controlled by the acquirer. Relative size of the entity. Sometimes what happens is two different entities are coming together to acquire another entity, but because of the relative size of one entity over other entity, where all other factors remaining the same, based on the parameters, we will also take the entity having a relative size higher than the other entity as an acquirer. So these are all the indications of acquirer. Let us take an example. In this case, what we are saying is that A Limited and B Limited acquired to combine their operations and form C Limited. So that means there is a transaction which is happening, demerger of its operations, and C Limited will be formed and they will combine the shares. All the shares of the entity A and B are exchanged for new shares of entity C. A's fair value is 550, B's fair value is 450. The shareholders of each entity maintain the same relative ownership interest in the combined entity. Entity A shareholders own 50% voting rights and all the non-voting shares in entity C, and B's shareholders own 50% of the voting shares. There is no provision for joint control, so entity C is not a joint venture. Entity C's board has 8 members, 4 of whom are appointed by entity A's shareholder, 4 by B's shareholders. None of the directors have a casting vote. It is a hypothetical situation. Equal rights for both entities to appoint 4-4 directors without any casting vote. Always it will be a tug of war when any decision comes in, right? So normally it is not there. But to derive a factor that shareholding is not the only the factor, or composition of the board of directors is not only the main factor, you should also move into the other factors. In this case, the fair value of the business of A is 550, fair value of B is 450. And if you see, both of them are having voting rights of 50-50, and the balance of 100 is coming as a non-voting rights. In simple terms, because of the size of the relative entities, A will be considered to have control according to Ind AS 103, even though other factors remaining to be the same. Because of the relative size, you can consider A as the acquirer. Okay, we know a person who takes the control over the other business is the acquirer. Why it is important? He will be accounting for the business combination. And okay, when he will account for the business combination? He will account for the business combination on the date of acquiring the control. The date on which he acquires the control is called acquisition date in step 2 of Ind AS 103. In step 2 of purchase method or acquisition method as per Ind AS 103, obtains control. Generally, this is the date on which the consideration is passed on and the entity acquires all the assets and liabilities of the acquiring. But I'm using the word generally. That doesn't mean that means that without even transfer of consideration, sometimes control may be obtained. How that is possible? Let's take one example where we were talking about a scenario where ABC Limited acquires entity A 100% for cash. The sale agreement specifies that the acquisition date is 10th March. As per the agreement, it is 10th March. Nominates its directors and appoints them in place of the existing directors who are resigned on 5th of March. The shares are transferred and consideration is paid only on 15th of April. What is the acquisition date? Think over. So what we have said, the date on which the entity acquires the control or obtains the control over the acquiree. In this case, what is the date on which actually the control is being acquired? Here the control is being acquired even without transfer of consideration. The moment the board of directors have been appointed, that is the date on which the accounting of Ind AS 103 has to be done. It is not on 15th of April where consideration has been transferred. So you have to be very, very careful when actually the transfer is happening in respect of this particular situation. So we have to always see what is the exact date on which control is passing. On the date, you have to consider that as the acquisition date, because that is the date on which you are going to acquire account for the business combination. What happens if it is a court scheme? because in court scheme there could be little bit of complexity which will be coming in, because the court may say this is the specified date on which you will account for the transaction. Whether the specified date should be taken into consideration or the date on which the transfer of money has to be taken into consideration, or the date on which the board of control over the board of directors has to be taken into consideration. So all three possible situations could be there. Let us look into that with an example. Here A decided to acquire B under a scheme of amalgamation. The scheme is approved by the board of directors of two companies on 1st July 2014. The scheme provides that subject to the High Court approval, any profit or loss arising out of the operations of B Limited from 1st July 2014 will belong to A. So that means from 1st July, all the risks and rewards of ownership will come to A Limited. The scheme also provides that purchase consideration payable by A to B will be based on entity's net assets value as at 1st July 2014. Which will be determined by an independent valuer. So the basis of assets or consideration is also determined based on the date on which the consideration is being or valuation is being payable, 1st July 2014, where it is approved by the both the directors. The appointed date for the scheme is 1st July 2014. Effective date as per the scheme is the date of its filing with ROC. Scheme is approved by the shareholders on 31st August 2014. Scheme is approved by SEBI on 31st October. High Court approves the transaction on 15th of March 2015 and it's filed with ROC on 22nd of March 2015. A is preparing consolidated financial statement for the year ending 31st March 2015. On what date it is considered to have obtained the control of the entity B? We have so many dates: original, effect, appointed date as per scheme is 1st July 2014, but scheme will be approved by the shareholders on 31st, High Court will approve it on 15th March, then ROC filing will happen on 27th March. With so many dates, how we have to look into that? Which is the date on which actually the control happens? We have to consider this particular discussion. The date of acquisition is generally the date on which acquirer obtains control. So in our case, either 1st July 2014 because that is a specified date, or it is 31st August where the scheme is approved by the shareholders and I am entitled for taking over the shares versus the board of directors. It may be 31st. In some cases, an agreement will provide the acquisition date on a specified date. In this scheme of arrangement, we have said the scheme of arrangement says specified date is nothing but 1st July. Irrespective of any date given in the agreement, the date of acquisition is the date on which control is actually obtained. This may or may not correspond to the specified date in the agreement. So it may not be 1st July. It may or may not be 1st July. It may or may not be August 31st. But what is important is whether control has been obtained on 1st July or control has been obtained on 31st August. That is what we have to see. In some cases, a business combination cannot be finalized without a regulatory approval. So in this case, 15th March is the date on which the High Court approves the scheme. So in what is to be considered in this particular example is whether the approval by the regulatory process is substantive approval or it's only a procedural approval. If I'm saying it's substantive, meaning without that the scheme cannot be implemented. So here, unless the court approves, you cannot implement the scheme. So to that extent, what happens is the date of acquisition cannot be earlier than the date on which the High Court approves the transaction, because only on the date the substantive right is coming into that. After that, you have the SEBI has approved it, you are talking about filing with the ROC. Those are all procedure because it's not substantive. Whereas getting the approval of the scheme, because the accounting treatment is specified as per the scheme. So the approval of the scheme by the High Court is a substantive approval in this case, and accordingly, The standard says it should be accounted only on the date on which the court has approved it. This is also supported by other point. There is an argument. It says that the accounting standards cannot prevail the Companies Act as per the notification given in MCA GSR 111E for India's implementation. It says that the accounting standards cannot overrule the Companies Act. In case of any difference between these two, the Act will prevail over. That is what given in the notification for implementation of accounting standard. So this argument also goes that without the approval of the High Court, Section 232 subsection 6 says the scheme shall clearly indicate an appointed date from which it shall be effective, and accordingly it is not a date subsequent to the appointed date. Appointed date in this case will be the date on which it has been approved by the court. Okay, court says it is March 31st, but you give effect as of 1st July 2014. Till 31st March 2015, I cannot give any effect. I have to wait till March 2015. Assuming that the approval is happening only in 10th of April 2015, then I cannot give any effect in 31st March financial statement, even though the scheme is effective as of 1st July 2014. That is coming out of the Companies Act. Another argument is that, forget about that, on 31st March, majority of the board is the nominees of the acquiring companies, and accordingly, Ind AS 103, that is the control, is passing on that particular date. Another argument could also be possible. You have to actually see what is the fact and circumstances of the case. But my understanding or my view is that if the court has specified a particular date as the appointed date, that should be used for the purposes of accounting and after getting the approval by the court. That is what you are supposed to see according to Ind AS 103 as well. Let's take another example, but not it's a court scheme. Here we are talking about ABC Limited and XYZ Limited are manufacturing rubber components. ABC Limited made a bid to purchase XYZ Limited's business. Entire business is being purchased. The Competition Commission announces that the proposed transaction should be scrutinized as per the competition law, that it is not breached. Then only it will be approved. So even though the contracts are made subject to approval of CCI, ABC Limited and XY Limited mutually agree that the terms of acquisition and the purchase price before competition authority clearance is obtained. So all other things have been done except the approval by the Competition Commission. Whether the approval by Competition Commission is substantive. If it is significant, if the approval is not coming in, the entire structure has to be cancelled. Then it's substantive. No, it is only procedural. There are cases where they have applied this and they are getting it, and it normally they don't reject it. Then it becomes a procedural aspect. But in this case, it seems to be substantive, and to that extent, it cannot account for this as a business combination till such time the Competition Commission approves this particular scheme. That is an important aspect which we have to consider, right? Substantive, the date of acquisition cannot be earlier than the date on which the approval is obtained from CCI. Let us take another example. X Limited makes an offer to buy all the shares of Y Limited, which is only owned by Z Limited. Pending transfer of shares to X Limited, the parties agreed that X Limited should be consulted on every major business decisions, whether the offer date can be considered to be the date of acquisition. You have to see, what do you mean by consultation? It's only a consultation. Is it a substantive right or it's a protective rights? It seems to be a protective rights, and accordingly, offer date cannot be taken as the date on which control passes from Z Limited to X Limited in respect of the business of Y Limited. And accordingly, it does not have the power, so control is not exercised. Because control is not exercised, you cannot account for as per Ind AS 103. Now, could there be an acquisition date without any consideration being transferred? from one party to another party. I'm expecting that you will recollect what we have discussed earlier. Yes, we are talking about a case where there is a buyback. An event can also happen. There is no need for a transaction. In a transaction, there will be a sale consideration. But if an event happens, there is no requirement for any purchase consideration. And even without a purchase consideration, control may be transferred from one entity to another entity. And the other entity, which is now obtaining the control, should recognize the entire transaction by means of Ind AS 103. So purchase consideration may be non-existing in a scenario of an event which gives control of the business to one particular entity. So we have understood what is the who is the acquirer and what is the acquisition date. Two steps have been done. On the acquisition date, in the books of acquiree, what you will do is you will recognize the consideration which has been transferred based on the consideration may be assets transferred, liabilities which is incurred for the previous owners, and the equity shares which has been issued. So you have to determine what is the consideration based on all these things. So I may be transferring some asset, I may be also settling a liability of the owners, plus I am also paying equity shares. All put together will be the consideration. When I am saying assets transferred, it is not asset transferred by the acquiree to the acquirer. Acquirer also transfers some other assets other than equity instrument. Maybe cash is paid along with the equity instrument. That's an asset transferred. And another possibility is, there are some liabilities which are not actually taken over as part of the business acquisition, but the owners are having, previous owners are having in their personal capacity. I am settling that liability separately. That will also be a payment. Instead of payment of equity or asset transferred, I am settling their liability. There is an outflow of resources. All put together should be my consideration based on the fair value on the acquisition date. Suppose if I have incurred any related acquisition cost, that should not be added to the consideration. It should be treated as an expenditure according to Ind AS 103. AS 14 says the transaction cost is incurred for purchasing this, so you can add to the purchase consideration. Whereas here it says acquisition related cost should be debited to the P&L account and cannot be part of the consideration. What do you mean by cannot be part of the consideration? When you decide what is a goodwill or capital reserve, this acquisition cost will not be taken into consideration. So they will be simply ignored. It will be charged to the P&L account as sunk cost. Suppose if you have incurred any cost for issuing your equity or issuing your debt, that will also not part of the consideration, but should be treated as part of accounting treatment comes under financial instrument standard. So you have to go to that particular standard and you will not have anything to be done under this particular standard. Now let us take an example. Stamp duty paid on acquisition of land pursuant to a business combination be capitalized as part of the cost of asset, or should it be treated as an acquisition related cost, or should be expensed with. Okay, when I'm saying part of acquisition related cost, it should be expensed with. Part of asset means I'm taking over certain assets for which the stamp duty is incurred. Whether I am supposed to take that as part of purchase consideration which I am paying, or I have to treat that as an expenditure. Stamp duty is actually an expenditure which has to be treated either as an expenditure, or if it meets the criteria of an asset. In this case, I think that the stamp duty is for acquisition of a land. So to that extent, it can be considered as cost of the land as per Ind AS 16. But whether it's part of the combination consideration, business combination consideration, no, it is not part of that. It is actually happening subsequent to the acquisition to ensure that I'm going to continue the control or the rights or transfer of the rights to my name. So to that extent, it is not part of the consideration. because it is not part of the consideration, it should not be considered for determining your goodwill or capital reserve, as the case may be. It should be, if it is an other expenditure, it should be charged to P&L. But it's a stamp duty relating to land, it meets the recognition criteria as per Ind AS 16, so it will be added, but never be treated as part of the consideration. Let me take another example. Here ABC Limited acquires PQR Limited. The assets acquired from PQR Limited includes an intangible assets, which is a license. For this intangible asset, ABC is required to make an additional one-time payment to the regulator in PQR's jurisdiction in order to get the name transferred. Whether such additional payment to the regulator is an acquisition related cost, that means when I'm saying, is it a transaction cost, it's part of the consideration. Again, it is after I have purchased it, and it has to be treated as part of the asset cost. So if I apply the same principle what I have done for the stamp duty for the land, para 53 of Ind AS 103 says that it should be expensed with on the date of acquisition, or if it meets the recognition criteria of an asset, you add it. For example, in this case, intangible asset has to be registered in my name, for which I am paying the additional license fee. So I will consider this expenditure is going to increase the value of that. It is a direct expenditure incurred to register the value of the intangible assets in my name. So I will add it according to Ind AS 38. Otherwise, it will go to P&L account. Another interesting fact which is coming in is contingent consideration. What do you mean by contingent consideration? Assuming that A Limited acquires B Limited in a transaction, and they say, A Limited says, I will pay you 100 crores in advance as part of the consideration. If the business which I have acquired from you is increased by 50% in next 2 years, I will pay you another 10 crore. What happens? 100 crore is a fixed compensation consideration. 10 crore is dependent on future event. So what is the possibility of the entity is going to have more than 50% increase in the turnover of the entity within the next 2 years has to be assessed. And if the entity concludes, we have to consider that as part of the contingent consideration. So what it has to be done, you have to recognize that as a fair value of the item, and to that extent there could be a liability which will be created because you are agreed to transfer additional fund or maybe additional equity based on completion of a particular specified conditions. So to that extent, we normally consider that as part of our transaction, where it will be treated as part of your contingent consideration. So what is expected is, you have to assess what is the level of contingency which you will be able to overcome. To that extent, you will take that. Let us take an example. In this case, what we are trying to say is that A acquired B Limited, acquisition consideration is 20 million in cash. Okay, additional consideration of 20 million will be paid if B succeeds to achieve certain specified performance target. Now, I have taken an example of 50% of increase in the turnover within the next 2 years. They might have fixed anything like that. Entity A determines the fair value of the contingent consideration at 15 million. So what it says is that you cannot take the entire 20 million. What is the fair value of that particular contingent consideration should be taken into consideration as part of the consideration. At a later point of time, the probability of meeting the set performance target becomes lower. Actual happening, it becomes lower. How this has to be accounted for? What it says is that on the acquisition date, you should consider 15 million, which is the fair value of the consideration, and it is to be settled for a variable amount of cash. Such consideration would be nature of financial liability rather than equity. So the corresponding credit will be given to a financial liability, but I will take that as my consideration for determining the goodwill or capital reserve, right? But in the subsequent year, after I have accounted the goodwill or capital reserve or whatever, what has happened was the 15 million is going to be met. So to that account, the financial liability should be remeasured. The remeasurement says that the liability is need not be going to be paid. Then to that extent, whatever I have already considered should be reversed in the P&L account, not reversed in the goodwill or capital reserve, should be reversed in the profit and loss account. That is what the accounting treatment for contingent consideration. You have to be careful on contingent consideration with respect to this. And let us see the other aspect of this by means of another example. Here it says, additionally, amount equivalent to 10% of the profit in excess of INR 10 crore generated over the next 2 years in cash in lump sum at the end of the 3 years. So in that case, ABC Limited determines the fair value of that contingent liability, the 10% whatever profit which they have to share is as 1 crore on the date of acquisition. After the year, because of better than initially projected performance, in the previous case we have seen that the projected performance, we have said that it has come down, so the liability is getting reversed. To that extent, it is credited to the P&L account. In this case, the initially assessed performance is actually going up. Now, we expected to go up. The fair value has gone up to 2.5 million, 5 crore instead of 1 crore at the end of the first year. How the accounting should be done? What it has to be done is that the additional of 1.5 crore in the subsequent year shall be recognized in profit and loss account, not in your adjustment into your capital reserve or goodwill. For a simple reason, acquisition accounting has already been done. Subsequent adjustment is nothing but a change in estimate. That the change in estimate has to be accounted on a prospective basis, not to restate the previous year numbers. And to that extent, it has to be accounted in the profit and loss account. Okay. So the financial liability will come down to that extent. The liability actually comes down, right? Or goes up. It goes up. So to that extent, the 1.5 crore will be debited to my P&L account with a corresponding credit to the financial liability till such time it is actually settled, right? Let's look into some more examples. Here we say entity will pay 4.5 crores at the acquisition date and place the 50 lakhs in an escrow account. But the acquisition is 5 crore. 4.5 crore has been initially paid on the date of acquisition. But subsequently, 50 lakhs has been paid in the escrow account of the entity. And when it is going to the escrow account of the entity, whether that should be treated as part of purchase consideration or should be treated as a contingent consideration. In this case, be very, very clear that there is no question of you having anything relating to contingent consideration. Consideration is 5 crore. What it is actually saying is that 4.5 crore will be immediately paid. 5 crore will be kept in escrow account. In case if there are any warranty or other claims which is coming in, I will adjust that 50 lakhs. Sorry, not 5 crore. It's a 50 lakhs. So total consideration is 5 crore. So the 50 lakhs is nothing but part of the consideration which is already considered. So again, I should not consider it as part of my acquisition consideration. Okay. What should be part of my business combination? That means what should be taken as part of my purchase consideration? You have to be careful. Let us take some example. transaction entered into primarily for the benefit of the acquiree or the former owner. When you are having a transaction for the benefit of the former owner, then that is be part of any payment which you are making to them is part of the business combination consideration. Suppose if the transaction is entered primarily for the benefit of the combined entity after the acquisition is being done, it is not part of the business combination. It's subsequent to that. That is what we have also seen, right? I paid stamp duty, I paid approval fees to intangible assets, etc. That is for the benefit of the combined entity, not for the previous owner, former owners. So it is not part of the business combination. And another thing, there could be likely that it will be separate from business combination. There are certain transactions which has not to be treated as part of your consideration for business combination. For example, I am purchasing B Limited. A Limited purchases B Limited. When I am purchasing B Limited, there is already a sundry creditors, or I am supposed to pay a trade payable which is owned by me to B Limited, because B Limited was my supplier. That pre-existing relationship, whatever amount I am transferring, is payment of my normal liability before the business combination, and to that extent it is not a liability which I am knocking off, right? It should be considered as separate from business combination. Whatever consideration I am paying, that should be taken for determining your goodwill or capital reserve. This amount should be treated as a repayment of your existing liability. Similarly, there could be some scenarios where one entity is being acquired by another entity, and one condition says that the key employees of that entity should continue to be in employment for at least another 5 years in the newly formed entity or the combined entity. Normally what happens is, this will be a situation where a startup company or a technology company is acquired from the owners of that. The owners will be the technocrats, and they also own the company. When it's being purchased, we wanted to use their expertise for at least 5 years, till such time I'm capable of handling my clients, right? Or the existing clients, the business transactions with respect to the combined entity. So for that purpose, normally this type of arrangement will happen, where we will say, we will give you a consideration of 5 crore for acquiring your business. Another 20 lakhs will be paid if all the 4 directors of the company continue to be the key management personnel of this company for the next 3 years. Or maybe I will take it as 2 years. So 20 lakhs has to be accounted, right? If that 20 lakhs has to be accounted, whether I have to add it to 1 crore plus 20 lakhs as a consideration for the business combination, or I have to take only 1 crore as a consideration for business combination, 20 lakhs as amount paid for other than the business combination, that is for getting the services from the employees for the next 2 years. In that case, this is an employee cost, and it says that you have to recognize that 20 lakhs outside the business combination. That means you should not adjust that amount also as consideration. Take the 20 lakhs as an expenditure in the agreed period. Maybe 2 years, equally 10 lakhs, I will account for it. I recognize the liability for 20 lakhs upfront, or I have to recognize only when they have fulfilled the condition. Normally, I will fulfill that condition in the year of completion of the employment. So first year I will recognize 1 year after they have completed, 1 year related cost, that is 10 lakhs. And second year I will recognize balance. Suppose if 4 of the directors are supposed to continue for 2 years, but 2 have left, proportionate reduction will happen in the particular year in the employee cost. But never ever that type of arrangement will be considered as contingent consideration or fixed consideration for determining your business combination accounting. Similarly, there could be a situation where the acquirer agrees to reimburse any transaction cost which was made by the acquiree or the business owners. So for example, I wanted that the stamp, the intangible to be transferred in that name. I have said that you please carry on the necessary processes and whatever cost which you are incurring, I will reimburse that cost. And they are coming out with asking for a reimbursement of another 10 lakhs. Whether that 10 lakhs has to be taken as part of my purchase consideration? No, it should be a transaction cost. It should be accounted for as an expenditure on the acquisition date. If it is recognizable as an asset, you add it to the cost of the asset. Otherwise, you charge it to the P&L account as we have discussed earlier with some examples. Now, here we are saying that ABC Limited acquired a beverage company BQR Limited from XYZ Limited. So XYZ Limited is the acquirer here. At the end of the acquisition, BQR Limited is being sued for damages of 2 crore after the acquisition has happened. At the time of acquisition, XYZ Limited has indemnified ABC Limited for the losses, if any, due to the case for amount up to 1 crore. The fair value of the contingent liability for the court case is 70 lakhs. Now, should ABC Limited account for the contingent liability and the indemnification asset? Necessarily, yes, because you are saying there is a 70 lakhs of outflow at the date of acquisition, which is ready, which is indemnified by XYZ Limited. So even though the amount is 1 crore, the fair value is only 70 lakhs. So I will recognize the contingent liability of 70 lakhs. But at the same time, there is an indemnification cost which I have to collect it from XYZ Limited. So to that extent, that 70 lakhs will also be accounted as an asset. So the effect on goodwill or capital reserve will be nil. But the accounting treatment should be given because of the assessability or determination which comes in at the time of the acquisition, that it's a asset and liability existing on that particular date. Now, how we move on to third category. So what we have now done, the first step is identifying the acquirer, then identifying when he actually acquires the control over the other entity, acquire the acquisition date. And third step, we have said that what is to be accounted as the consideration or the assets and liabilities which are transferred, that we have considered as part of step three, right? Step four, because the consideration is based on the assets which are being transferred or taken over and the liability which is also assumed, we are trying to find out what is the net fair value of the assets taken over minus the consideration paid. If there is an excess consideration paid, that is a goodwill that we know pretty well. That is what we recognize. But how the goodwill is recognized, if you see that it says excess of the aggregate of, first you have to identify what is the aggregate of this three. Fair value of the consideration transferred. What is the actual consideration you are transferring? Second, what is the amount of non-controlling interest which has to be recognized if it is not 100% acquisition? Suppose if you are talking about a step-by-step acquisition, what is the fair value changes in respect of the previously held interest in the acquiring business? 30% I previously held, another 30% is acquired now. What is the fair value changes of the 30% from the date of my original acquisition to the date of the control being taken? That should be also added. Fair value of consideration received plus the amount of non-controlling interest plus the fair value of my existing interest, previously held interest. This is an aggregate amount. This should be in excess of my assets and liabilities taken over. So I might have taken over assets, taken over liabilities. Those assets and liabilities are measured as per Ind AS 103. We'll see what you mean by Ind AS 103. It says that it should be fair value of assets taken over, fair value of liabilities taken over. You cannot take cost. That is what the important requirement which we are talking about, right? So on that basis, we account for this particular item. On one side, consideration plus non-controlling interest plus the fair value of previously recognized, previously held equity interest in the acquiree minus the net value, fair value of the assets taken over. Okay, very clear. There is no big difference between AS 14 and this. Only difference is here we are talking about fair value of consideration. We are talking about fair value of previously held interest and fair value of the assets and liabilities taken over. There it may be totally consideration received, consideration transferred, non-controlling interest plus the previously held interest minus the assets and liabilities which is taken over. Maybe it may be cost also in certain cases permitted as per AS 14. Goodwill will always be considered as a residual. Please keep this word in your mind. Residual, that means if there are some assets or liabilities which are not actually appearing in the financial statement of the acquiring, but they are existing based on the assessment made, identified by the acquirer, then that should also be accounted, then only goodwill should come in. Without that, you should not consider your goodwill. That is an important aspect. Let's take this example. FMCG company acquiring an online e-commerce company B with the intention to start doing retailing. The e-commerce company has over the period have 10 million registered users. However, the e-commerce company does not have any intention to sell the customer list. Should this customer list should be recorded as an intangible asset in the business combination? In this, they have specifically said that it is not part of it. The intention is not to transfer will not affect the assessment whether to record this as an intangible or not, because the database can be used to other players or company E has the ability to transfer this to them. Accordingly, does not give you a legal or contractual right, and the separability will be, it has to be assessed based on separability. So it will not be treated as an intangible asset, but whether it will be kept out for the purposes of considering my business combination, whether I am taking that as a business, except that particular intangible asset, whether business itself is not taken over, whether it will not be considered as a business combination, that will not get affected. Only that particular intangibles will not be recognized. What do you mean by non-controlling interest? Interestingly, the standard gives two options. One, it says that you can measure the non-controlling interest by seeing what is the fair value on the date of acquisition and treat that as a non-controlling interest. So add that to the consideration paid and then derive your goodwill. When you are measuring the non-controlling interest at its fair value, this result in a full goodwill being recognized in the financial statement of the acquirer. Suppose if I am not using this model, I am going to say whatever is your proportionate net assets, you take it over. That is what non-controlling interest. I don't want it to fair value your interest. In that case, I am recognizing goodwill only partially, because I am taking over only my proportion of assets and I am saying this is your proportion of assets and liabilities. So your non-controlling interest only to the extent of whatever I am combining 100%, out of which 20% is relating to you. When I am saying that, goodwill also accounted only to that extent of 80%. Understood? So in that case, I am recognizing partial goodwill, that is what is relating to 80% is accounted for and not 100%. So goodwill can also be accounted on full goodwill basis or partial goodwill basis. Normally, partial goodwill or full goodwill will be determined based on what is the way which you decided to account for your non-controlling interest. If it is based on fair value, full goodwill. If it is proportionate asset of NCI, then it is partial goodwill. Interestingly, suppose if I am acquiring two or more businesses in the same year, can I follow full goodwill method for certain purchases, business combination, and for other business combination I wanted to apply partial goodwill method? Is it permitted? Yes, it says this option can be exercised combination by combination. You can apply by combination this particular situation, and to that extent you can actually find out what is the impact which is arising on your goodwill, partial goodwill, or the full goodwill. That means in three combination you will have partial goodwill, two combination you will be having full goodwill. Both are permitted. Only thing which is required is that you have to disclose your interest, how you have recognized as part of your disclosure with respect to Ind AS 103. Let us try to understand this by putting some numbers, because I don't have an Excel working, but the Excel working is coming in the example itself. 31st March, it acquires 60% of B Limited for 2 lakh rupees. So what is the full value? 2 lakh rupees is for 60%, means full value is, you have to gross up 2 lakh divided by 60% into 100%. So 2 lakh divided by 60 into 100 gives me around 3333 is my full value of the business, right? Fair value of identifiable net assets of B Limited is 3000 lakhs. So even though we are saying business is 2000 lakhs I have paid for 60%, they have not asked, in this example they have given the fair value itself. That means they are saying fair value is only 3000 lakhs. But what I have considered, I am paying for 60% of the business. So 60% of the business is 3333 minus 3000. There is a goodwill of 333, which is actually paid. Consideration where I am grossing up, I am actually paying higher than that. Whether I will recognize the entire thing like that, or I have to do it a different manner. What we have seen, consideration plus NCI plus previously held interest. In this case, previously held interest is not there. So consideration which I am paying is 2 lakh rupees plus my NCI minus my net assets taken over should be my goodwill. If I am taking, this is a normal procedure. If I am taking fair value of NCI as my obligation, then I have to take into consideration full goodwill. If I am taking proportionate method, I should find out what is the goodwill attributable to the minority interest or non-controlling interest. I should not use the word minority interest. It should be non-controlling interest. In that case, partial goodwill is recognized. Let us understand how we work on that. If I am talking about a partial goodwill, what is my fair value of net assets? It's 3 lakhs, right? 3 lakhs on which non-controlling interest is 40%. So 40% gives me 1200. So what goodwill should be? Goodwill is excess of aggregate of consideration paid plus non-controlling interest minus fair value of net assets taken over, right? In our example, consideration paid is how much? 2 lakhs plus NCI full value, partial value which we are taking is 1200. So 3200. What is the fair value of net assets which I am taking over is 2000, right? The acquisition cost which I, consideration paid is 2 lakhs, right? Plus 1200 minus what is the fair value of the consideration of business is 3000. So 200 becomes my goodwill. So I am coming back. Partial goodwill means NCI is accounted as proportionate of the net assets for the NCI. So what is the proportionate net asset? 40% of 3 lakh rupees. 3000 lakhs. So that is 1200 lakhs. What is my goodwill? Goodwill says it is consideration paid plus non-controlling interest minus fair value of net assets taken over. In this example, consideration paid is 2000 lakhs. NCI is 1200 minus fair value of assets taken over is 3000 lakhs. So net goodwill is 200 lakhs. Sure, 1200 plus 2000 minus 3000. It's a partial goodwill and partial NCI being accounted. NCI being accounted, not partial. NCI being accounted in proportion to the net assets owned by NCI. That's option one. What is option two? In option two, we are saying fair value of NCI to be taken into consideration, not what is the percentage attributable to the NCI. So in this case, my consideration paid remained 2000 and the fair value of my, 2000, fair value of my NCI is 1300 minus the value of net assets I have taken over is 3000. So 300 lakhs will be the goodwill. Clear? In this case. So this is full goodwill is recognized here. In this example, I am taking the full goodwill into the books of accounts of the entity, and NCI is also recognized to that extent. Okay, so this is two methods, both are permitted to be accounted for, and it can be applied on combination by combination as an accounting policy choice. What do you mean by gain on bargain purchase? Suppose if the amount or amount whatever I am talking about is not additional amount I have paid over and above the fair value of assets taken over plus the non-controlling interest plus the fair value of the previously held interest. If it is not the case, then if it is not going to be an excess consideration paid, it's a consideration paid is lower than the net assets which has taken over, then it's a gain on bargain purchase. Since the word used is a gain on bargain purchase, IFRS 3 says it should be credited to the profit and loss account in the year in which the acquisition has been or the control has been done or the acquisition has been accounted for in the P&L account on the acquisition date. But in India, we never had this concept of crediting to the P&L account, but we are treating that as a capital reserve. So accordingly, Ind AS 103 says, whenever there is a gain on bargain purchase, you have to check whether your existing accounting is correctly done or there are some issues. For example, it says that you have to revisit your assumptions relating to identification of assets and liabilities. For example, you might have fair valued your assets at a higher figure, fair valued your liabilities at a lower figure. Identify whether that becomes a situation where you are actually assessed at a net assets at a higher price. So bring down that to a real figure by revisiting the assumptions. Also see whether any other assets or liabilities has to be identified and recognized over and above what is appearing in the books. Suppose if the liabilities are identified and recognized to that extent, it will bring down the capital reserve, right? And also see the fair values which you have considered is correct or not. Maybe in the first case, the measurement itself is incorrect. In the last case, it is a fair value of the assets which has been recognized is also incorrect. So go and revisit. Even after that, if you are still having the gain on bargain purchase, recognize the resulted gain in the OCI and accumulate the same as capital reserve. So OCI will be in the OCI in P&L, you will recognize that. And then from OCI in the statement of changes in equity, you will move it to capital reserve. That is what the accounting treatment required. Whereas this will be credited to the P&L account. That is what IFRS 3 says. It is a carve out from IFRS 3 scenario. Now, we are now coming to allocation of the consideration, whatever we have done as a step 5. In step 5, it has to be allocated based on the fair value of the related identifiable assets and identifiable liabilities. Sometimes what happens is some intangible assets or any other asset which is not there in the balance sheet may also meet the recognition criteria. You will also bring in that identifiable asset. You remember that when we were discussing on intangible asset standard, Ind AS 38, we said identifiable asset in a business combination. And we also took an example of one entity which developed formulations, another entity is acquiring that. The formulation which was not used in, by the previous entity is capable of being exploited by the new acquiring the acquirer. So acquirer attributes a fair value to that particular intangible assets also. So you have to allocate to all the identifiable assets. The word used is identifiable asset. It's not as per the balance sheet. Similarly, identifiable liabilities. Maybe you have an obligation to pay just because of that particular acquisition, and that liability, even if it is not recognized in the P&L account, and it is also agreed that no reimbursement will be called for from the previous owners, then you are assuming that liability additionally. That will also be taken into consideration to determine your allocation of your consideration. When you are identifying the assets and liabilities based on their fair value, that should be debited and credited. So net figure will come in minus your consideration. That will be a goodwill. And of course, when you are talking about non-controlling interest in respect of a consolidated entity, you will also see the non-controlling portion. When you apply 60% or you are acquiring less than 100%, what is the fair value of the goodwill which you have to take into consideration? So you have to see that principle as well. Only one exception. Instead of fair value, what they are saying is, in case if there are any non-current asset held for sale has been identified, that should be recorded at fair value less cost to sell. Not at fair value, less cost to sell. That is the only exception. In all other cases, the asset should be recognized at fair value. The liability should be recognized at fair value. Now, whether the acquired items qualify to recognize as an asset in the business combination, let us try to understand. I am taking over assembled workforce. That is whatever workforce the entity has already had. When I am taking over, whether the workers is an identifiable asset, not an identifiable asset, because I may not be able to control the workers. Okay, because of that, whatever is considered as the assembled workforce which is available, it is already as subsumed in the goodwill. So accordingly, I should not create that as an additional asset. This asset is nothing but represented by means of additional consideration I am paying towards that business, because you created the workforce, which is talented workforce, right? On that basis, it is not a separately identifiable asset. It's subsumed in the goodwill. Contingent asset, not to be recognized unless it meets the definition of an asset. So you have to assess whatever is the contingent asset which is sitting in the financial statement, contingent liabilities which is sitting in the financial statement. You have to make an assessment on the acquisition date. What is the probability of it becomes an asset? What is the probability of the contingent liability become a crystallized liability? To that extent, that should be taken over in determining the qualifying asset or liability to be recognized, identifiable asset or liability to be recognized. But that should be recognized based on the fair value. Potential contracts with the new customers. So again, what happens is that when you say, like, I have talented workers of so many numbers with me, similarly, I am also saying so many customers contracts are available with me. Those customer contracts can also be transferred to you. So those customer contracts have a value to me. So I will attribute a value to that customer contract, whether it is possible. Two reasons: it is not separately identifiable. Second, you don't have a control over the customer contract, whether the contract will remain same or not. And another thing is, the reason why you are paying an amount over and above the net value of the asset is because they have potential benefit arising of the new customers. That's the reason why it is also considered as subsumed in the goodwill and you will not consider that as a separate asset. Future contract renewables. So here, suppose if I am saying there are possibilities of certain contracts which can be renewed, it is very clearly come out when I am entering into that agreement. Because of that, there is going to be some future benefits arising out of it. So that contracts are not subsumed in the goodwill, but those contracts are clearly defined. It gives me a value, right? To that extent, I can consider that as part of an identifiable asset. But very rare circumstances this will happen. But the other cases, you have to make your assessment and consider that as either subsumed in the goodwill or maybe contingent upon future event, but the probability of it becoming an asset or liability should be considered to inclusion, for the purpose of inclusion. Asset valuation elements. What is mean by asset valuation elements? Let us take that. Acquirer can recognize separate provision for impairment on a financial asset, which is measured at fair value for the business combination on the date of acquisition. Is it correct? Tricky? See, there is a specific thing, again, common sense. What it happens is that on the date of business combination, you are supposed to measure it at fair value, right? And the moment you have recognized that as a fair value, there is no separate valuation allowance is there. It is already adjusted in that particular situation. Accordingly, you cannot recognize a separate valuation allowance by taking the asset at a higher price and determining a goodwill in a different scenario and subsequently creating a valuation allowance. Not possible. So any changes subsequently on the reporting date, that is your asset, that is deteriorated. But on the date of acquisition, fair value of the asset taken over, taken into consideration the valuation allowance. So you cannot make a further adjustment as per paragraph B41 of Ind AS 103 in respect of an impairment of your financial asset. Okay. How the goodwill should be treated? What AS 14 says? Goodwill should be amortized over 5-year period, right? But whereas here, goodwill should be treated as an asset measured at cost, that is nothing but the residual value, right? Consideration paid minus net value of assets taken over minus non-controlling interest. So it is recognized at cost. Subsequently tested for impairment, not amortized as per Ind AS 103. It is only tested for impairment. You remember that we have said in discussing about impairment of asset, Ind AS 36, that there should be an annual impairment test. The moment you have goodwill on business combination in your books of accounts, annual impairment test should be done at a periodical basis, a particular period of the year, even if there is no indicators, and then recognize the impairment loss, if any. I have tested annual impairment in February. In March, based on that assessment, there is no impairment. But in March, the business has gone for a different scenario, maybe a COVID-19 related issue. To that extent, that COVID-19 issue makes me to make an additional assessment. It's an indication of impairment. One annual impairment test, which is mandatory, is even without impairment, indication of impairment. The other one is there is an indication of impairment, then I have to even test it for again on the reporting period. And if there is a fall, that should be accounted as an impairment loss. So no amortization which will be taken, that is only in AS 14. Another interesting factor comes is, I have not determined what is the value of certain assets which we are going to take over. We are not determined that particular item, but the control has been handed over. So what the acquirer can do is that he can account based on the provisional values, whatever information which is available at that point of time, and what is going to be considered as an additional charge, not contingent consideration, based on the amount itself is based on, say for example, it says that based on the future value of the share prices, or maybe a future commodity price index, or future index relating to that. So they are going to fix the entire consideration based on that particular situation. So how I will determine that? It is not based on a particular event, it is based on a particular index. How I will determine that? So it says provisionally what is the present scenario based on your estimate, you recognize that. That is what a provisional accounting, and update the provisional accounting within 12 months when you have the actual numbers. Only 12 months window is given. From the acquisition date, not from the end of the reporting period. From the acquisition date, 12 months window is available for updating your provisional accounting. So when you are updating your provisional accounting, what will happen? All the numbers you will substitute. So that means your consideration will get substituted, assets taken over will be substituted, fair value of the liabilities will be substituted, and to that extent there is an adjustment to goodwill or capital reserve will also happen. So all the numbers are trued up. That's what we are talking about when we are adjusting for the provisional accounting done for business combination in the next 12 months, right? When we say that, any depreciation will also be applied from the date of acquisition. Suppose if it is a depreciable asset, I should apply on the revised number. If the fair value goes up, then on the depreciable asset, I should recompute what is the depreciation to be adjusted, not from the adjustment date, right from the acquisition date. So 6 months depreciation has to be additionally applied. That should also be applied in the year in which you are revising your provisional accounting with actual numbers. The comparative information should also be revised, because this number, there is no actual outflow, but these numbers are provisionally adjusted as per Ind AS 103, and you are applying Ind AS 103 in the current period also. So you are going to apply this on a retrospective basis on the date of acquisition with the new information which is available. So comparative should also be restated in the to match this with the current year accounting, which is done based on the actual number, whereas the comparative originally done with the provisional will now restate it based on the actual numbers. This is what we call it as a provisional accounting of business combination. Here what we are saying is that ABC Limited acquires PQR Limited in a business combination. PQR Limited assets include a manufacturing plant with ABC Limited, which ABC Limited plans to phase out over the next 3 years to 5 years. ABC Limited also planned to align the customer's warranty of PQR Limited with its own more favorable terms. ABC Limited proposed to record the plant at a nominal amount in the business combination and to recognize a warranty provision based on its intended settlement terms. Is the management intention is correct? ABC Limited on the acquisition date wanted to recognize the plant not at fair value but at a nominal price because they are going to phase out. Similarly, warranty provision based on new intended term, not based on what has been accepted by the acquiree or up to the date of acquisition. So whether it is possible, it says the plant should always be recognized at fair value. Okay, immediately after the impairment, after the business combination has been done, you have to test it for impairment because you are planning to phase out, right? So impairment testing is a separate accounting, not to be considered on the date of acquisition to determine your net value of assets taken over. Assets should be based on the fair value which is allocated for the plant, right? Similarly, for giving more generous warranty settlement is not a liability, because this is a liability which you are going to give after acquisition based on your business plan. So to that extent, what was the original contractual terms on the acquisition date should be considered as the assumed liability. So both cannot be adjusted even on a provisional basis. Subsequently, when they are adjusting, is it a provisional adjustment? No. It is something which is happening subsequent to the acquisition, nothing relating to the provisional consideration, and to that extent you should not make anything as an adjustment to the business combination, no restatement of the previous numbers. It is to be accounted as an impairment loss in the subsequent year. Warranty provision change in estimate in the subsequent year. Okay, not part of the business combination. Let's take another example. So ABC Limited acquires BQ Limited, a competitor, to increase the market share by taking the competition brand out of the market. So they are going to buy and kill the market, kill the brand. The management has therefore proposed to measure the brand at a minimal value, as it will be removed from the market shortly after the acquisition. Is the management proposal appropriate? Again, it is not appropriate, because on the date it has a value. Subsequently, you are changing the usage of the asset. Then it is an indicator of impairment, test for impairment. That is what a separate accounting treatment and nothing to do with Ind AS 103 as a provisional accounting. So you should not restate any of the numbers. It should be only tested for impairment in the year. Another possible situation is, step by step I am acquiring the entity. Previously I had 30%, another 30% has been taken. So previous year I have recognized as my associate investment. This year it becomes a control. On the date when I am taking the control, I have to recognize business combination accounting as per 103. So how that should be considered is a special consideration of step acquisition. What it says that you have to remeasure the previously held equity shares at fair value on the date of acquisition. Then that fair value changes. What is the original cost of investment minus the fair value should be recognized in the P&L account. Indirectly, if you see the concept, as if it is sold. If it is sold, what you will do? You take it as your gain in the P&L account. Take that. And then if fair value changes is previously recognized in OCA, then account the fair value changes in the OCA itself. If it is fair value through P&L, it goes to P&L. Otherwise, it goes to fair value through OCA. It goes into that particular situation. You are clear on that? Now, suppose if I am saying this particular situation, what happens to my goodwill? So because I have fair valued my existing investment to the fair value as on the date of acquisition, what is I am paying additionally for the 30%, right? That 30% alone, if I work out based on my consideration, the goodwill will be correctly determined. The NCA will now undergo a change. Previously, I was an NCA. Now, the balance subscribers will be an NCA. That will also be accounted for. That is the reason why previously held interest has been fair valued and upgraded to that extent. Okay. So how this has to be accounted for to determine goodwill or capital reserve? Only thing additionally we are adding is fair value of previously held interest. Okay. All other items remaining the same value. This because 30% becomes 60%, and if I'm only considering 60% straight away, it is incorrect, right? That is the reason why we are considering this fair value of consideration transferred plus recognized amount of non-controlling interest, maybe full NCI or partial NCI, plus the fair value of previously held interest minus the fair value of net identifiable asset. That if it results in a asset, then that becomes a goodwill. If it results in a gain, then it will be recognized in OCA and accumulated in capital reserve. Clear? So simple terms, only this is added, whatever we have seen on a straight acquisition instead of a step acquisition. Okay. Now we are coming to another interesting factor, common control transaction. What do you mean by common control transaction? As I have already told that before the acquisition and after the acquisition, the entity under the same common control, maybe the same shareholders or same parent company or same ultimate parent company. So if that is the case, that's what we are saying, both before and that, the control is not transitory, it is remaining the same, it is not changing. In that particular situation, it may be same party or parties, it may be group of individuals acting together, it need not necessarily an entity, it may be even group of entities which are acting together, could also be under a contractual arrangement, maybe a common control transaction. It is something different in US GAAP. US GAAP is not considering this particular aspect, and I don't want to confuse you with US GAAP. Here, if there is a contractual arrangement, two shareholders have agreed for it, and they remaining the shareholders for the other entities also, even individuals, it will be a common control transaction. Similarly, one entity acquires another entity, and that entity has invested in another entity, and subsequently, the third entity is merged with the previous entity, that's the intermediate parent company. Then the ultimate control remaining with the A Limited, right, the first company. So a company may have the same controlling stake before and after, or group of individuals through a contractual arrangement can have this. In that case, common control transaction can be applied. What is common control transaction accounting? You cannot account based on fair value method or the acquisition method. What you are supposed to do is you have to account for pooling of interest method. In fact, the appendix C says you have to account it as per pooling of interest method. I am using the word accounted for similar to pooling of interest method as per AS 14. What you will normally do, assets and liabilities are combined with a carrying value. So my asset, acquired entity's asset, both will be added together at the carrying amount, no fair valuation. Similarly, no new assets or liabilities will be recognized, no identifiable asset, no identifiable liabilities. So if it is identifiable, that should have been part of my common control already. So it should not be accounted for. And prior periods should also be restated as if the business combination has occurred at the beginning of the previous period, because it's a common control transaction. Previous year, it is also my own assets. This year is also my own asset. Accordingly, if it is consolidated as a one single entity, I should consolidate the comparative amounts also. That is what my common control transaction says. And your reserves will be on the same basis. The identification of the reserves will be retained. Only the capital reserve, very, very rare circumstances, will be share capital issued plus additional consideration minus share capital of the transferor. That has to be taken into consideration as the capital reserve. Very, very rare circumstances. If capital reserve comes in, normally because there will not be any goodwill arising, there will not be any capital reserve arising unless there is an additional consideration which has been paid, but very rare circumstances in a common control transaction. So if it happens, that should be shown separately from other capital reserves, right? This is what your common control transaction. Let us try whether it's a common control transaction. ABC Limited and XYZ Limited are owned by four shareholders, B, C, D and E. Okay. Both entities are owned by a group of individuals, A, B, C and D. Each of them holding 25%. So that means individually none of them are having any control over that entity. But B, C and D have entered into a shareholders agreement, and they say that we will exercise the joint control over that entity. So what happens in this structure? If I say four people, the three people together will always vote, and accordingly they control ABC Limited before the ABC Limited as well as and of course they are the shareholders, right? And they are the shareholders of B, the XYZ Limited also, right? So in that case, suppose XYZ Limited is being combined with the ABC Limited or merged with the ABC Limited as part of Ind AS 103, whether I have to apply my principles of fair valuation or common control transaction. because this 75% of the people will vote in the same pattern. So similarly here also they are the shareholders, because they are remaining the shareholder, whether ABC Limited and XYZ Limited are under common control. Common, yes, it is by the group of individuals, it is a common control transaction, and accordingly you have to apply Appendix C of Ind AS 103, which says you have to use only the carrying value and not fair value. And the identity of the reserves will be retained. Capital reserve may be arising. If it arises, it should be shown separately from other capital reserves. Clear? One example we have seen. Let us take another example. Same situation. Only thing which we are saying that there is no agreement between any of the shareholders that they will exercise their voting power jointly. That means everyone will be having only 25%, 25%, 25%, right? So accordingly, none of them are controlling before, controlling after. Suppose if the entities are merging and the merger is happening, suppose ABC Limited takes over XYZ Limited, those conditions are not common control transaction, because it could be totally a different scenario where, say for example, B, the shareholder B contributes more to acquire the XYZ Limited, could be a possibility, right? In that case, it is not considered as a common control transaction, because there is no contractual arrangement where collectively they will exercise the control, which will remain at the same pattern after that also. And accordingly, this is not a common control transaction. In this case, suppose ABC Limited acquires the business of XYZ Limited, then that should be treated based on the fair value, not on carrying value. What is the major disclosures which we have to see as per Ind AS 103? One, in respect of each business combination which has occurred during the period, the following disclosures are required for each combination which has occurred during the period. What is the name and description of the acquiring? What is the acquisition date? What is the reasons for business combination, and how the control has been exercised over or obtained by the acquiring? Because if control is not obtained, you will not have the application of Ind AS 103. That's the reason why we are talking about that. What is the percentage of voting equity instruments which has been acquired in the combination? That should be, these four has to be given for each business combination which has occurred during the period. Okay. Now, in respect of identifiable asset for each business combination occurred during the period, what is the identifiable assets and liabilities which has been taken over as part of the business combination? What is the amount recognized at the acquisition date for each major class of assets and liabilities? So what are all the identifiable assets and liabilities, and what is the value which you have accounted in the books of accounts? Normally it will be more or less same, the same amount will be disclosed, right? And what is the contingent liability to be disclosed as per Ind AS 37? When you are taking over the assets, liabilities, and also you are taking over contingent liabilities after an assessment, right? So if it is probable that it will become a liability, you have taken that as an assumed liability. If it is not going to be a probable liability, you are going to disclose that as a contingent liability. So what is the contingent liability to be disclosed as per Ind AS 37? What do you mean by gain on bargain purchase? Why it resulted in a gain? Why you are taking that as part of OCI and capital reserve? That should also be disclosed. In respect of step acquisition, the acquisition date, fair value of the previously held interest, how you have determined, what is the value of that, you have to disclose. And what is the gain which you have recognized on remeasuring the existing previously held equity interest, what is recognized in the P&L, that should be disclosed if it is a step acquisition. Non-controlling interest, you have to determine what is the amount of non-controlling interest of the acquiree recognized on the acquisition date and the measurement basis, whether it's a proportionate share of asset or the fair value of the identifiable asset. So that is the assessment which you have to, that measurement basis also should be disclosed. For each non-controlling interest which is measured at fair value, what is the valuation technique which you have used? What is the key model inputs? to determine that value. That should also be disclosed. And of course, this valuation of fair value comes under 113. So 113 requires that. Anyway, that comes as part of the disclosure when you are taking fair value of the NCI as part of your accounting. So that means full goodwill, if it is recognized for certain business combination, you have to specifically talk about how the fair, what is the fair value, and what, sorry, what is the NCI, what is the basis, and if the basis is fair valuation, then what is the basis in which the fair valuation has been adopted. So these are all the major disclosure. Now, what is the difference between Ind AS and AS? Ind AS 103 compared to AS 14. Ind AS 103 is a very, very complex and extensive standard, right? You have seen that lot of guidance are coming in with respect to acquisition method, with respect to common control transaction, with respect to determining who is the acquirer, who, what is the date on which the acquisition has to be accounted for, what is the provisional accounting of business combination, what item can be identifiable asset and what cannot be identifiable asset, what is considered as contingent consideration, what is not to be considered as part of the contingent consideration or consideration for business combination, like when you are accounting or agreeing for certain amount to be paid for continuous of employment, then it is not part of the consideration paid for business combination. Extensive guide is given for the business combination under Ind AS 103. Whereas AS 14 is a simple standard which talks about the combination, maybe through purchase method or pooling of interest method, both are permitted. Whereas here, except common control transaction, all mergers, demergers, reverse merger, everything should be accounted based on merger accounting or acquisition method. Whereas purchase method as well as pooling of interest method is permitted for all business amalgamations as per AS 14. Pooling of interest method is permitted only for common control transaction, whereas it is an accounting policy choice under amalgamations. So you can decide whether you wanted to use pooling of interest method or you wanted to use purchase method. Both are given as an accounting policy choice in AS 14, whereas it is permitted only for common control transaction as per Ind AS 103. Resulting goodwill is not amortized, but it's subjected to annual impairment testing, and based on that, any impairment will be accounted in the P&L account. That is what Ind AS 103. Whereas goodwill on amalgamation is normally amortized over 5-year period. Transaction cost, which is incurred for getting that business combination done, should not be included as part of the business combination accounting. Otherwise, it is not to be considered as part of determining your goodwill or capital reserve, as the case may be. It should be treated as an expenditure on the acquisition date, whereas it may be considered as part of the purchase consideration as per AS 14. So with that, we are very comprehensively covered accounting for business combination, starting with what do you mean by a business? What do you mean by the core principles of control being obtained? Then you are moving to Ind AS 103. When you are moving to Ind AS 103, you should understand what is the two accounting principles available. One is for your acquisition accounting, which is to be applied for all except your common control transaction, where Appendix C of Ind AS 103 permits you to use only pooling of interest method. But when we have seen the accounting treatment, we have also seen what are all the other complexities like contingent consideration, provisional accounting, certain identifiable assets or liabilities to be included over and above what is appearing in that. You have to determine the fair value of the assets and liabilities to be taken over. You have to determine what is the portion of the non-controlling interest if it is not 100% acquisition. If there is a step acquisition, what you have to do with the previously held interest in the same entity. all those complexities which we have seen and their related accounting treatment plus the related disclosures. And also we have seen the significant differences between AS 14 and Ind AS 103. Even after this extensive disclosure, if you are having any specific questions or you are seeking for some specific clarifications or you make some comments to be made, please post it in our YouTube channel. It is my responsibility to respond to your comments, queries and questions in the channel itself to ensure that everybody gets a benefit out of your own doubt. With that, I take leave of you and we will meet with yet another Ind AS standard as part of our Ind AS knowledge series videos. Until then, goodbye, stay home, stay safe.